السلام عليكم ورحمة الله.
الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر. أشهد أن لا إله إلا أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن محمدا رسول الله أشهد أن محمدا رسول الله حي على الصلاة حي على الصلاة حي على الفلاح حي على الفلاح الله أكبر الله
الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونستهديه ونتوب إليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. وبعد عباد الله، فلنحمد الله تعالى على هذه الجمعة الثانية من رمضان. لا نزال في رحاب هذا الشهر الكريم، تحفنا رحمات الله سبحانه وتعالى، نتفيأ غلال الخير والبركة والجود من الله سبحانه وتعالى، فلنر الله سبحانه وتعالى من أنفسنا خيرا. حديث اليوم أيها المؤمنون سيكون تذكيرا لنفسي ولكم جميعا بأهمية وببعض فضائل الكرم والجود والخير والصدقة في هذا الشهر، وكذلك من خلال الحديث عن صور وأمثلة من جود الصحابة رضوان الله عليهم وبعض مراتب الصدقة وبعض آدابها ثم بعض فوائدها المتوخاة والمتوقعة منها. كل هذه المسائل مترابطة، فهي إما محفزات وأسباب لهذه النتائج أو نتائج متوقعة من هذه الصدقة. Dear respected brothers and sisters and elders, we should thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for reaching the month of Ramadan. We're still in the second Friday of Ramadan. We should be grateful and thankful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And today, inshallah, briefly, I will be talking about the importance of generosity, spending, and charity in this month of charity. I'm not going to speak about the mandatory charity, the mandatory spending, like someone to spend on his family, his father, his mother, his wife, his kids, or kafarat, the expiation, up to 7 of them. I'm going to speak about voluntary things. Why I'm speaking about it? Because we are in the month of Ramadan. Imam al-Tirmidhi rahimahullah narrated that from Anas, Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, the best of charity is a charity in Ramadan. Even though he said the chain of narration has a weakness in it. Yet we know that our deeds will be multiplied in Ramadan, whether they are good or bad. So it is very important to talk about this. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has invited us to spend for His sake. He said in Surah Al-Baqarah, مَثَلُ الَّذِينَ يُنْفِقُونَ أَمْوَالَهُمْ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ كَمَثَلِ حَبَّةٍ أَنْبَتَتْ سَبْعَ سَنَابِلٍ فِي كُلِّ سُنْبُلَةٍ مِئَةُ حَبَّةٍ وَاللَّهُ يُضَاعِفُ لِمَنْ يَشَاءُ وَاللَّهُ وَاسِعٌ عَلِيمٌ. The example of those who spend their wealth in the way of Allah is like a seed of a grain, which grows 7 spikes. In each spike is 100 grains, and Allah multiplies His reward for whom He wills. And Allah is all-encompassing and knowing. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us again in Surah Al-Baqarah, وَمَا تُنْفِقُوا مِنْ خَيْرٍ يُوَفَّ إِلَيْكُمْ وَأَنْتُمْ لَا تُظْلَمُونَ. And whatever you spend of good, it will be fully repaid to you, and you will not be wronged. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma described him, كَانَ أَجْوَدَ النَّاسِ وكان أجود ما يكون في رمضان حين يلقاه جبريل فيدارسه القرآن فلرسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أجود بالخير من الريح المرسلة. He used to be the most generous, even though most generous in Ramadan, when and where he meets with Jibril عليه السلام to recite the Quran. Then the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, his generosity is waxed faster than the rain bearing wind. Why? Why he was generous in Ramadan, even though he was generous before Ramadan? 3 short reasons. The first one of them, because of Ramadan itself, where good deeds will be multiplied and bad deeds will be multiplied. So it is good to spend in Ramadan. The second one, because he was reading the Quran, and the Quran itself includes and contains a lot of verses which tell us about the importance and rewards of spending. The third one is about company. He is companying a good person, Jibril alayhi salam. As the Arabs say, أنت في الناس تقاسو بالذي اخترت خليلا فاصحب الأخيار تعلو وتن ذكرا جميلا. People will compare you to your friends. So tell me whom you befriend, I will tell you who you are. His friend was Jibril alayhi salam, the angel of revelation, which is the best thing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can give to people as guidance. Yet, Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, yes, Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was the most generous, and he was in Ramadan. Why he told, that's why he told his companions, as narrated by Abu Huraira, لو أن لي مثل أحد ذهبا ما سرني أن يأتي علي ثلاث ليال وعندي منه شيء أدخره إلا شيء أرصده لدين, أو كما قال صلى الله عليه وسلم, which is in Bukhari Muslim, which means if I had gold equal to Mount Uhud in weight, it would not please me to pass 3 nights and they have a things of it left with me except what I retain for repayments of a debt. Khadija radiallahu anha was the most beloved wife to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam until her death. Even when he heard her sister Hala, he used to say, Allahumma Hala, Allahumma Hala. She described him when he complained to her about his first meeting with the angel. He said, Khiftu ala nafsi. She cited 4 or 5 characters which shows his nobleness, his goodness, and his own, you know, generosity. Wallahi la yukhzika Allahu abada. By Allah, Allah will never disgrace you. Innaka latasilu rahim. You have good relationship with your kin and kith. وتحمل الكل. You carry out on your shoulder the heavy things. وتقري الضيفة. You serve generously your own guest. وتعين الملهوف, you help the needy person. وتعين على نوائب الدهر, you help people when they are facing the hardship and the calamity. These are the characters of our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now, did he affect his own companions? Yes, indeed. Listen to the following story. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, the best of this ummah after Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the second after him, Umar radiallahu anhu, and the third, Uthman radiallahu anhu, briefly inshallah. In Surah 92, Surah Al-Layl, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us about the spending of our master Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu to emancipate and free our master Bilal radiallahu anhu. And he said, وَسَيُجَنَّبُهَا الْأَتْقَى الَّذِي يُؤْتِي مَالَهُ يَتَزَكَّى وَمَا لِأَحَدٍ عِنْدَهُ مِنْ نِعْمَةٍ تُجْزَى إِلَّا بِتِغَاءَ وَجْهِ رَبِّهِ الْأَعْلَى وَلَسُوفَ يَرْضَى. Who gives away his wealth, purifying himself, and have in his mind no favor from anyone for which a reward is expected in return, and soon will he attain complete satisfaction. وقد روى زيد بن أسلم رضي الله عنه كما في الترمذي وبداود أنه قال سمعت عمر عن أبيه قال سمعت عمر بن الخطاب رضي الله عنه يقول أمرنا رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أن نتصدق فوافق ذلك مالا عندي فقلت اليوم أسبق أبا بكر إن سبقته يوما قال فجئت بنصف مالي فقال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم ما أبقيت لأهلك قال قلت مثله وأتى أبو بكر بكل ماله فقال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم ما أبقيت لأهلك قال أبقيت لهم الله ورسوله. Imam al-Tirmidhi and Abu Dawood narrated that Zayd ibn Aslam radiallahu anhu said that he heard Umar ibn Khattab, may Allah be pleased with him, saying, we were ordered by the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to give in charity, and that coincided with the time in which I had some wealth. So I said, Umar said, today I will beat Abu Bakr. It is a very hard task, right? If ever I beat him, so I came with half of my wealth. And the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, what did you leave for your family? I said, the like of it, 50-50. 50 for his family, 50 for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and his Messenger. And Abu Bakr came with everything he had. So he said, oh Abu Bakr, what did you leave for your family? He said, I left Allah and his Messenger for them. Zero. He spent all of his money for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So I said, Umar said radiallahu anhu, I will never be able to beat him to some things. Uthman radiallahu anhu, Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in different instances and occasions, he said, ما ضر عثمان ما فعل بعد اليوم. I will cite one of them. And عبد الرحمن بن سمرة radiallahu anhu, قال جاء عثمان radiallahu anhu بألف دينار. هذا في جيش العسرة في تبوك حيث لم يكن هناك مال جهز ألفا بأحلاسها وأقتابها ونفقتها ومؤونتها. قال الحسن كان ذلك وقد وضعها النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم في حجره وصار يقلبها ثم قال ما ضر عثمان ما فعل بعد اليوم. حفر بئر رومة وجهز جيش العسرة جيش العسرة رضي الله تعالى عنه. So Uthman radiallahu anhu went to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with 1,000 dinar of gold. 1,000 dinar. And Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, and the narrator rather said, I saw the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam turning them over in his lap, saying, whatever Uthman does after today will not harm him twice. So the point here, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala orders us to spend, to give. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said that and he has also implemented it. His three best companions, just among many, gave the best of what they have. Now, we need to invest in our future. We need to give. So what are the layers or types of sadaqah that we can or should start with? عندما نريد أن ننفق أيها المؤمنون ينبغي أن ننتبه إلى الآتي وحديثي كذلك ليس عما أوجبه الله كما ذكرت سابقا من نفقة الزوجة والأولاد والآباء وإنما هي الصدقة العامة. أول ذلك أن تكون صدقة خالصة لوجه الله وأن تكون سرا بقدر المستطاع. The first thing is to be hidden and of course to be sincere. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, إن تبدوا الصدقات فنعما هي وإن تخفوها وتؤتوها الفقراء فهو خير لكم ويكفر عنكم من سيئاتكم. If you disclose your charity, if you disclose your charitable expenditures, they are good. But if you conceal them and give them to the poor, it is better for you. And He, capital He, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, will remove from you some of your misdeeds thereby. And Allah, with what you do, is fully acquainted. Second, to give it while we are healthy, while we are afraid of poverty, while we are alive, before we are on the verge of death, on the death bed. أن ننفق حال الصحة نخاف الفقر ونأمل الغنى قبل أن تصل الروح الحلقوم. يقول النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم: أفضل الصدقة أن تتصدق، أن تصدق وأنت صحيح شحيح، تأمل الغنى وتخشى الفقر، ولا تمهل حتى إذا بلغت الحلقوم قلت لفلان كذا وكذا، أي الوصية، وقد كان لفلان وفلان، أي للورثة، كما أوجب الله سبحانه وتعالى. Which means the best charity is to give when you are healthy and greedy, hoping to be wealthy and afraid of becoming poor. Don't delay giving in charity till the time when you are on the death bed. When you say, give so much to so and so, and so much to so and so, and that time the property is not yours, but it belongs to so and so, the inheritors or heirs. ثالثا أن تكون هذه الصدقة بعد ما أوجب الله. Third things to be from the excess, what we don't need, what we don't want. We have to start with our family first, then what is left, we should give it as a charity. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, يسألونك ماذا ينفقون قل العفو. They ask you what they should spend, say the excess beyond needs. And Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, لا صدقة إلا عن ظهر غنى واليد العليا خير من يد السفلى. العليا هي المعطية والسفلى هي القابضة. وابدأ بمن تعول، رواه البخاري والنسائي واللفظة. The best of charity is that which is given when you are self-sufficient. And the upper hand is better than the lower one. The upper hand is the one that is giving. The lower one is that is receiving. And start with those for whom you are responsible. Charity begins at home. We should start with that. رابعا عباد الله أن يبذل الإنسان ما يستطيعه ويطيقه مع القلة والحاجة. So for a man to spend from what he can afford, even if it's a little thing. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, and you see this term, this word is repeated, أفضل الصدقة, أفضل الصدقة, the best type of charity. That depends on the person who's giving it, depends on the situation, depends on the recipients. So it's not only equal, it's not always the time. For example, in the summer, أفضل الصدقة سقي الماء. The best of charity to give water, because people are thirsty, to quench their thirst. It is very important. So, عن جابر وعبيد بن عمير قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أفضل الصدقة جهد المقل. The best charity is what with the little property the man can afford to give. خامسا النفقة على الأهل. Fifth, to give more to the family. I'm not speaking about the mandatory spending. In Sahih Muslim, listen to the following hadith. عن أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم دينار أنفقته في سبيل الله ودينار تصدقت به على مسكين ودينار أنفقته على أهلك أعظمها أجرا الذي أنفقت على أهلك. أعظمها أجرا الذي أنفقت على أهلك. A dinar you spend in Allah's way or to free a slave or as a charity you give to a needy person or to support your family, the one yielding the greatest reward is that which you spend on your family. سادسا الصدقة على القريب. Six, spending on relatives and kindred. Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said في حديث سلمان بن عامر إن الصدقة على المسكين صدقة وعلى ذي الرحم اثنتان صدقة وصلة. Which means giving charity to a poor person is a charity, and giving to a relative is two things: charity and upholding the ties of kinship. Sisters, it's your turn now. Zainab al-Thaqafi رضي الله عنها was a wealthy lady, and she came to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم asking if she can give zakah and give money to her good and poor husband Abdullah ibn Mas'ud. The best one that Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, من أراد أن يقرأ القرآن غضا طريا فليقرأه على قراءة ابن أمي عبد. If someone wants to read the Quran as fresh and ripe as it was revealed, let him read it with the narration of Abdullah ibn Mas'ud. So she said, can I give him a charity? He said, yes, صدقة وصلة. It's a charity and also doing good things to your relatives. Seventh, the last one, inshallah, in this khutbah. النفقة على الجار. We should take of our neighbors. In a good hadith, Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, لا زال جبريل يوصيني في الجار حتى ظننت أنه سيورثه. جبريل عليه السلام was insisting on the rights of the neighbor until I thought he's going to give him a share of the inheritance. So Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said في حديث البدر يا أبا ذر إذا طبخت مرقة فأكثر ماءها وتعاهد جيرانك. أو أبو ذر, whenever you prepare a broth, put plenty of water in it and give some of it to your neighbors. It is very important to be kind to our neighbors, especially during Ramadan, going back and forth, driving around lately after Taraweeh. We should give them the good example. Remember that and bear in mind that Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has warned us about being bad neighbors. He swore 3 times, Wallahi la yu'min, Wallahi la yu'min, Wallahi la yu'min. By Allah he's not a believer, by Allah he's not a believer, by Allah he's not a believer. قالوا من يا رسول الله? They said, who is our رسول الله sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? قال من لا يأمن جاره بوائقه. They said, the one whose neighbor is not safe of his own, you know, harm. We should not harm our neighbors. We should not turn our volume on. We should not play outside to, you know, outside of the normal time. عباد الله, يسأل الله سبحانه وتعالى المغفرة وتوب إليه إنه هو الغفور الرحيم. Please ask Allah forgiveness so He may forgive us. الحمد لله المنعم المتفضل على عباده بما يشاء, والصلاة والسلام على أكرم الخلق وأجودهم, كان أجود الناس وكان أجود ما يكون في رمضان حين يلقاه جبريل فيدارسه القرآن. فلرسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أجود بالخير من الريح المرسلة. Dear respected brothers and sisters, after knowing the importance, some virtues of spending, some examples of the Sahaba, and some types and layers of charity and giving, now it comes to some etiquettes of giving the charity. In order for us to preserve our own reward and even to invest and get better return, we have to follow some of the following guidelines. The first one, we have to give it from a halal source, halal income money, and with sincerity. We have to spend from the halal that we have. عباد الله, بعد معرفة بعض فضائل الإنفاق والجود والكرم وذكر نماذج من جود النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وصحابته والحديث عن بعض درجات الإنفاق, ينبغي علينا أن نتكلم عن بعض آداب الإنفاق حتى نحافظ على هذا الأجر حتى لا يضيع. أول هذه الآداب أن تكون خالصة لوجه الله وأن تكون مما حلال. يقول الله سبحانه وتعالى, يا أيها الذين آمنوا أنفقوا من طيبات ما كسبتم ومما أخرجنا لكم من الأرض ولا تيمموا الخبيث منه تنفقون ولستم بآخذيه إلا أن تغمضوا فيه واعلموا أن الله غني حميد. Oh, you believe, spend from the good things which you have earned and from that which we have produced for you from the earth, and do not aim toward the defective their form, spending from that while you would not take it yourself except with closed eyes, and knows that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is free of need and praiseworthy. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, من تصدق بعدل تمرة من كسب طيب, أي بوزنها أو قيمتها, ولا يقبل الله إلا الطيب, فإن الله يقبلها بيمينه ثم يربيها لصاحبها كما يربي أحدكم فلوه أو فلوه, كما يربي أحدكم فلوه أو فلوه, وهو مهر الخيل الأنثى الصغيرة, حتى تكون مثل الجبل. متفق عليه. Which means the messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, he who gives in charity the value of a date which he legally earned, and Allah accepts only that which is pure, Allah accepts it with his right hand and fosters it for him as one of you fosters his mare until it becomes like a mountain. Again, to be from the best of wealth we have. النفقة من أفضل ما عندنا. لن تنالوا البر حتى تنفقوا مما تحبون. You will not attain righteousness, تقوى, بر, الجنة, until you spend from that which you love the most. ثالثا وأخيرا إن شاء الله, أن لا يمن ولا يستكثر وأن لا يبطل عمله. يقول الله سبحانه وتعالى, يا أيها الذين آمنوا لا تبطلوا صدقاتكم بالمن والأذى كالذي ينفق ماله رئاء الناس ولا يؤمن بالله واليوم الآخر فمثله كمثل صفوان عليه تراب فأصابه وابل فتركه صلدا لا يقدرون على شيء مما كسبوا والله لا يهدي القوم الكافرين. Which means, or you believe, do not make your charity worthless by reproach and injury, like him who spends his property to be seen of men and does not believe in Allah and the last day. So his parable is as the parable of a smooth rug with earth upon it. Then a heavy rain falls upon it. So it leaves it bare. They shall not be able to gain anything of what they have earned. And Allah does not guide the unbelieving people. Again, someone has to do it before his death. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said at the end of Surah Al-Munafiqun, Surah 63, last verse number 10. وَأَنْفِقُوا مِمَّا رَزَقْنَاكُمْ مِنْ قَبْلِ أَنْ يَأْتِيَ أَحَدَكُمُ الْمَوْتِ فَيَقُولَ رَبِّ لَوْلَا أَخَّرْتَنِي إِلَىٰ أَجَلٍ قَرِيبٍ فَأَصَّدَّقَ وَأَكُمْ مِنَ الصَّالِحِينَ وَلَنْ يُؤَخِّرَ اللَّهُ نَفْسًا إِذَا جَاءَ أَجَلُهَا وَاللَّهُ خَبِيرٌ بِمَا تَعْمَلُونَ. Which means, and spend in the way of Allah. From that we have provided you. Before a death approaches one of you and he says, my Lord, if only would you delay me or give me a respite for a brief term, so I would give charity and be among the righteous. But never Allah will delay a soul when its time has come, and Allah is acquainted with what to do. Now, we know the virtues, the merits of spending. We have been following it, following some etiquettes. We have doing it. What we should expect from Allah, both in this life and in the hereafter. We'll be brief, inshallah ta'ala, mentioning three outcomes and results in this life and in the hereafter. عباد الله حينما ننفق وبإخلاص وفي مراتب متعددة من الإنفاق ماذا نتوقع من الله سبحانه وتعالى وهو الكريم الذي حثنا وندبنا على الإنفاق نتوقع الكثير في الدنيا والآخرة سنذكر ثلاثة أمثلة في الدنيا وثلاثة أمثلة في الآخرة إن شاء الله تعالى. أولها عباد الله وكلنا يبحث عن ذلك السعادة والطمأنينة والهناء. The first outcome in this life is happiness, which everyone runs after. Sometimes they take a pill, sometimes they take drugs, you know, and sometimes they do a lot of things, beer, wine, TV, nudity, music, this and that. Yet there is a void in the heart which cannot be filled without iman. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Baqarah, this is a glad tiding for those who spend for the sake of Allah. الَّذِينَ يُنْفِقُونَ أَمْوَالَهُمْ بِالْلَّيْلِ وَالنَّهَارِ سِرًّا وَعَلَانِيَةً فَلَهُمْ أَجْرُهُمْ عِنْدَ رَبِّهِمْ وَلَا خَوْفٌ عَلَيْهِمْ وَلَا هُمْ يَحْزَنُونَ. The ones who expend their riches by night and the daytime, secretly and in public, then they have their reward from the providence of their Lord, and no fear will be on them, neither will they grieve. ثانياً لن ينقص المال من الصدقة بل إنها تزكيه وتطهره وسيزداد المال. Second one, charity will never decrease your wealth. Rather, it will purify it. It will increase it, and Allah will give you more. Is that my words? Listen to the following hadith. Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam made an oath on three things. أقسم قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم ثلاث أقسم عليهن أولاهما ما نقص مال من صدقة. The wealth of a man will not diminish or will never be decreased by sadaqah. That is very important. And every day, as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in Bukhari Muslim, ma min yawmin ma min yawmin yusbihu fihi al-ibad illa wa malakani yanzilan yaqulu ahaduhuma allahumma a'ti munfiqan khalafa wa yaqulu al-akhar allahumma a'ti mumsikan talafa. Every day two angels descend every morning and one says, O Allah, give him who spends something in the place of what he has spent. The other one will say, O Allah, give destruction to him who withholds. Third and last one, just for the sake of time. As-sadaqatu a'ilaju min al-amrad. Yashfi Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala biha al-nas. Duna an ya'ni thalika adama akhdi al-asbabi wa al-dhahaba ila al-tabibi wa istikhdam al-himyati wa istikhdam al-asbab. La tusiu fahmi aw tafhamuni ghalatan kama yaquluna bil-ammiyya. The third one is that charity can heal the sickness. That's not my saying. Having said that, we have to go to doctors, physicians, we have to take our parts, to take the pills, and to follow strict diet. Don't leave that, because that is among the asbab that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, asked that to do. As Umar al-Khattab said when he was taking some, you know, medication, he said, هي من قضاء الله الذي نستعين به على قضاء الله. It is a part of the divine decree that we use to get help with other divine decree of Allah, which is sickness. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in hadith Abu Umamah al-Bahili, Dawu mardakum bis-sadaqah. Dawu mardakum bis-sadaqah, which means treat your sick by giving sadaqah. It's a good hadith, as Imam al-Bani rahimahullah said. This in this life, وللآخرة أكبر درجات وأكبر تفضيلة. آخرة has higher ranking and better favors. People on the day of judgment in the Jannah, they will see people like we see the stars, not those stars, you know, in Beverly Hills, you know, on LA. No, the real stars, 500 years a top. Buy a dime, buy $5, buy this food, buy that clothes you gave for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What we should expect on the day of judgment? Number one, أن نكون تحت غل الله سبحانه وتعالى يوم القيامة. To be shed, to be under the shade of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The hadith of the seven people who will be under the shade of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, one of them, رجل, a man, a woman, لغو لا خرج مخرج الغالب. There is no mean or need for the gender or sex here. رجل تصدق بصدقته فأخفاها حتى لا تعلم شماله ما تنفق يمينه. A man who spends by his right and he hid it so much so his left hand does not feel or know how much he spent by his right. Let alone his wife, let alone his community. He's not going to take the mic and say, okay, I have given $200,000 for ISGD. Allah knows, if you're sincere, that's fine. But we should make some our charity as, you know, hidden. The second one, inshallah ta'ala, if it's combined, it's a good recipe for getting to Jannah. It's a quarter, 25% of the following, or the four things, if we add them to it, it's a guarantee ticket to the Jannah, inshallah ta'ala. Number one is charity. The second one is fasting. Number three is following janazah. Number four is visiting the sick. الصدقة وزيارة المريض واتباع الجنائز وصوم يوم كما في حديث أبي بكر رضي الله عنه وهو حديث مشهور صحيح. قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فمن تبع من أصبح منكم اليوم صائما قال أبو بكر أنا قال فمن تبع منكم اليوم جنازة قال أبو بكر أنا قال فمن أطعم منكم اليوم مسكينا قال أبو بكر أنا قال فمن عاد منكم اليوم مريضا قال أبو بكر أنا فقال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم ما اجتمعنا في امرئ إلا دخل الجنة رواه مسلم ما اجتمعنا في امرئ four qualities if someone make them on the same day be fasting and giving charity and following a janazah and visiting a sick person these four things inshallah ta'ala will give him a free pass to Jannah which is the next door ذلك أن يدعى من باب الصدقة من أبواب الجنة الثمانية to be called from a gate of الصدقة among the eight gates of Jannah. Again, also there is Babu Rayyan for fasting people. And Abu Bakr was very ambitious. And I'm not going to say the hadith, but it's a famous hadith in Bukhari Muslim. And he said, Ya Rasulullah, مَا عَلَى مَنْ دُعِيَ مِنْ كُلِّ هَذِهِ الْأَبْوَابِ Prophet said, this is the hadith, if someone is giving charity, he will be called from the gate of charity. Someone who's fasting, always, that is majority of actions, will be called from the charity gate. If someone is giving protecting his salah and praying more will be called from the gate of salah. Abu Bakr said, "Ma ala man du'iya min kulli hadhihi al-abwab." If there is any harm if someone can be called from all of these gates, he said, "No, wa inni la arju an takuna minhum." There is no harm, and I hope that you'll be among them. How many accounts Umar Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu have done? So, dear respect, brothers and sisters, I know tomorrow we have fundraising. We have a big gathering for the family, for the whole community. We should come. But the masjid itself is a part of that. We should look at the big picture, the whole spectrum. We should give for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for iftar, for the needy people, for the refugees, for those who have not, and to give for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And listen to the following three restrictions finally, inshallah ta'ala. The first one of them, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us in Surah Al-Talaq, may Allah save all of our families from that. Surah Divorce, Surah 65, verse 7. لينفق ذو ساعة من ساعته ومن قدر عليه رزقه فلينفق مما آتاه الله. Someone may say I'm not a millionaire. I don't have six figure salary. I don't have, you know, $2 million. You can give $5, $1. You can volunteer 1 hour. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said what it means. Surah 65 verse 7. Let the rich man spend according to his means. And the man whose resources are restricted, let him spend according to what Allah has given him. Allah puts no burden on any person beyond what he has given him. He, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah will grant after hardship is. Second one, and I've heard it some people. They say, okay, I have been given. Can we count how much Allah has given us since our birth? We cannot. So let's not be stingy. Listen to the following warning from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Hadith Asma radiallahu anha. قال يا أسماء أنفقي ولا تحصي فيحصي الله عليك ولا توعي فيوعي الله عليك أي تضيقي جمع فأوعى. Do not tie up so Allah will tie up his provision on you. And do not count how much you have given for the sake of Allah. And Allah will tell you, remember when you was a child, when you was first grader, fifth grader, middle school, high school, you remember the tie, the phone, the ticket, money, hospital, accident that he saved you from, sickness. Can you, we cannot. وَإِن تَعُدُّوا نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ لَا تُحْصُوهَا. If you try to count or enumerate Allah's blessings, you cannot. We cannot. Even the sighting, the hearing, the digestive system we have, the blood circulation, you know, dialysis. We don't have to go to dialysis 3 times a week. We cannot. We have to be appreciative. We have to be thankful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Third and last things, inshallah ta'ala. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us, and we know that we're going to die, definitely. But what comes after death matters most, more than the death itself. When we die, all of our good deeds will be sealed, except from 3 things in the major hadith. The following hadith I'm going to mention includes 7 things. Imam Suyuti rahimahullah and Imam Al-Sakhawi in his book, famous book of hadith, he said, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam قال, إن مما يلحق المؤمن من عمله وحسناته بعد موته علما علمه ونشره وولدا صالحا تركه أو مصحفا ورثه أو مسجدا بناه أو بيتا لابن السبيل بناه أو نهرا أجراه أو صدقة أخرجها من ماله في صحته وحياته تلحقه بعد موته. رواه ابن ماجة وابن خزيمة والبيهقي. وقال العجلوني في كشف الخفاء هذا كتاب مشهور إن الحديث عند الترمذي في إسناد حسن. فقال صلى الله عليه وسلم سأل. What it means, the reward of the good deeds that will reach a believer after his death are a knowledge which he taught and spread, a righteous son whom he leaves behind, he makes dua for him, a copy of the Quran that he leaves as a legacy. There is a program here, $2 per copy. They want to have a mushaf in every hotel room, in every school, $2 per copy. You can have it. You can do that for yourself, for your parents, on behalf of your parents, inshallah ta'ala, or in any masjid. A mosque that he built or participated in it to preserve it, to keep it running. And a house that he built for wayfarers, for orphanage, as an orphanage, for orphanages, orphans, for orphans. That is fine, inshallah ta'ala. Lastly, a canal, before last one, a canal that he dug. And lastly, or a charity that he gave during his life, during his lifetime, when he was in good health. These deeds will reach him after his death. And definitely, definitely, we will need it and want it at that time. So we better be safe than to be sorrow at that time. If we don't spend now, we will regret it. I'm not going to say give it to this way or that way. Definitely the masjid is needy. Other projects are. But diversify your investments. جزاكم الله خيرا. Please move forward. We're going to conclude with dua. جزاكم الله خيرا. Please make it easy for brothers. They are waiting the hallway. We're going to finish now. Just making dua, inshallah. اللهم اهدنا فيمن هديت، وعافنا فيمن عافيت، وتولنا فيمن توليت، وبارك لنا فيما أعطيت، وقنا واصرف عنا شر ما قضيت. اللهم يا واصل المنقطعين وصلنا إليك. اللهم تقبل صيامنا وقيامنا وركوعنا وسجودنا وتهجدنا وسائر أعمالنا. اللهم اغفر ذنوبا علمتها وما علمها الناس. اللهم لا تكشف سترك عنا يا رب العالمين. اللهم اشفنا واشف مرضانا ومرضى المسلمين. فرج كروبنا وكرب المسلمين. اللهم اقض الدين على المدينين. اللهم زوج أيمنا وارزق عقيمنا. وفق الطلاب ونجحهم وفهمهم وعلمهم يا رب العالمين. اللهم احفظ أبناءنا وبناتنا من كل سوء وبلاء. اللهم اغفر لنا ولأزواجنا وآبائنا وأمهاتنا وإخواننا وأحبابنا ومشايخنا. اللهم اغفر لآبائنا وأمهاتنا. رب ارحمهم كما ربونا صغارا. اللهم يا رب جازهم عنا خير الجزاء. اغفر لميتهم في هذه الساعة يا رب العالمين. وافسح له في قبره مد البصر. اللهم اشف حيهم وهده وعافي واختم لنا وله بخير. اللهم بارك لنا في مسجدنا هذا وبارك للمسلمين في مساجدهم يا رب العالمين. اللهم اهد النساء المسلمات، اجعلهن مؤمنات محجبات، احفظهن يا رب أن يفتن أو يفتن يا رب العالمين. ارزقهن الستر والكفاف والعفاف والغنى. بارك لهن في أزواجهن وإخوانهن وأبنائهن وآبائهن. اللهم أعطنا ولا تحرمنا، وأكرمنا ولا تهنا، وأعنا ولا تعن علينا. يا أرحم الراحمين، يا أرحم الراحمين، يا أرحم الراحمين، ارحم عبادا لك مستضعفين في كل مكان. اللهم أنجي المستضعفين من المؤمنين والمسلمين في كل مكان. اللهم اهلك الظالمين، خذهم أخذ عزيز مقتدر، أرسل عليهم الطوفان والجراد والقمل والضفادع. اللهم احصهم عددا واقتلهم بددا ولا تبق منهم أحدا. فرج يا رب عن اللاجئين والمهجرين والمحاصرين. يا رب فك قيد أسرانا وأسرى المسلمين في سجون الطغاة والجبارين. اللهم أهلك الظالمين بالظالمين. اللهم يا رب لا ينقضي رمضان إلا بذنب مغفور وسعي مشكور وعمل متقبل مبرور. اللهم انصر دينك وكتابك وسنة نبيك وعبادك المؤمنين. اللهم اجعلنا من يتصدقون في السر والعلن. اجعل كل أعمالنا صالحة ولوجهك خالصة ولا تجعل فيها لغيرك شيئا. اللهم اعطنا ولا تحرمنا وأكرمنا ولا تهنا وأعنا ولا تعن علينا. ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار. اللهم اقض ما في علمك من حوائجنا وحوائج المسلمين وبارك لنا جميعا فيما رزقتنا وقنا عذاب النار. اللهم أحسن عاقبتنا في الأمور كلها وأجرنا من خزي الدنيا وعذاب الآخرة. بلغنا يا رب ليلة القدر وعرفنا إياها وفقنا لقيامها وتقبل ذلك منا. اللهم صل على محمد في الأولين وصل عليه في الآخرين وصل عليه ما تعاقب الليل والنهار وصل عليه ما ذكره الذاكرون وسهى عن ذكره الغافلون. عباد الله إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون. فاذكروه يذكركم واشكروه على نعمه يزدكم ولذكر الله أكبر والله يعلم ما تصنعون. وأقم الصلاة.